There comes a time in everyone's life where we must face the truth. But what is the truth? Did existence really begin with the Big Bang? Is what we've been taught in our history books some sort of fictional reality? It's hard to find the truth in a world full of lies. However, we do have the strength within us to find the truth, to unveil it, and present it to the world for what it really is. It's your world, your reality, your truth.
Welcome, everybody, to Unveiling the Truth. I'm your host, Mark Howitt, and today's date is March 1st, the first day of March, and there's snow everywhere. Where I'm living, it's very chilly, very cold, and I know that's likely to be expected in Canada, but other parts in the world as well are also feeling the cold, the extended winter, as they say. I'd like to start off by thanking everybody and welcoming you to the show. First time viewers, anybody who hasn't checked out the show yet, thanks for joining. And also to all the people in the chat room who come and tune in every week, week in and week out. I thank you for your continued support and viewing, as well as to everybody who checks out the video and shares it to their pages and checks out the website, likes the pages and the broadcasts, as well as everybody who responds to the material that I put out. This one here, Hitler's Escape from Germany, is the 21st episode of Unveiling the Truth. We're coming along. I did do a couple midweek broadcasts, which I'll be replaying a bit later on. However, I do plan to continue doing that, not just on Saturday nights, but other midweek broadcasts as well, just to get some more information and material out there for you guys. You know, there's so much stuff I'm wanting to tackle here on this show, so many guests that I want to get on. There's not possibly enough Saturdays in a whole year to do that, so I do need a bit of other broadcasts, which is why I am choosing to do other broadcasts, not just on Saturday nights. As well, I'd like to mention at the end of this show, a new show on the Truth Broadcast Network is starting, and that is Conspiracy Wire with Mike Pichesny. He's also the host of the Rundown Live, but anybody who wants to check the show out after this broadcast, it'll be starting at midnight. Right after this one, so stay tuned after this show for an episode of Conspiracy Wire. I'm not sure if it's the first one, but I know it's a new show that Mike has out, and I'm going to check it out after the broadcast for sure. So I want to thank everybody for joining me today on Unveiling the Truth, and what an episode we have today. As you know, as I stated, Hitler's escape from Germany, a very controversial and touchy subject. It's mixed. The opinions about this, the response was mixed, and this episode here is going to be a blue pill or red pill episode. You either take the red pill or you take the blue pill. That's the simple reality of it, folks. I've dug up a lot of information for this episode, and I don't want to waste any time really talking about it, just introducing it. I'm going to get right into things. As an introduction, what got me into looking into this? Well, I watched a documentary a few years ago, and it was titled The Two Deaths of Adolf Hitler. And that was actually a season finale, I guess. There was a series put out called The World at War, and they had a lot of episodes. And The Two Deaths of Adolf Hitler was the last episode of the series. And when I watched that, I was pretty amazed, you know what I mean, that there was two deaths of Adolf Hitler. You know, that was kind of strange because I thought he died in the bunker. I thought he committed suicide by either shooting himself in the head or taking a cyanide capsule. That was my belief before watching that. After watching that episode, they were debating whether he killed himself or took cyanide, as well as the Russian account versus the German account. There was a lot of controversy there, and there was a dental assistant on that episode that said that she identified Hitler's teeth as being his, and therefore they claimed that it was Hitler's body. And then they took the parts of Hitler's remains, which was his skull cap, a jawbone, the Russians did anyways, and they put that evidence under a vault, under a lock and key. So that was one of them, and then the other one was that they burned his body outside the bunker. It's been a while since I watched that episode, and I couldn't find it on YouTube actually when I looked for it afterwards. But I do have a copy of it. I downloaded it a few years ago and managed to back it up on a disc so that I could watch it in the future. So I did watch that, a couple months ago. But the first time I watched that was a few years ago. And after watching that, I didn't really think too much of it. I thought, okay, well, there could be something here. I went on for a little bit of time without really looking into it again. But something made me trigger it in my mind again to think about this. Actually, recently, in the last few months, I've really been studying World War II, the different battles that happened. I'm actually three quarters of the way through a book now called Stalingrad, about the Battle of Stalingrad. Definitely one of the most brutal battles of World War II. Hand-to-hand, close-range combat, door-to-door, room-to-room. And actually, that battle is essentially what the SWAT teams now use. They use that same kind of tactics in SWAT team training and stuff like that, room to room, clearing rooms, clearing buildings, up to streets, and of course cities. That's what they were trying to do. But the German army couldn't get their tanks through the streets. There's a lot of obstacles and strategic problems the Nazi army had getting through Stalingrad, and that battle essentially crushed the Nazis and allowed the Russians to sweep through and topple Berlin later on. So that's definitely an interesting battle in World War II. But after looking into all these World War II stories and hearing veteran testimonies and stuff, and just what they went through, the profound warfare that they went through, I remembered about the two deaths of Adolf Hitler. So I started looking into it a little bit more, and I discovered a couple books actually on the subject where there was claims that he escaped to Argentina or South America. That's one of the claims that I was seeing consistently in my research. So I wanted to prove this. I wanted to figure out if it was true or false. And after digging and digging and digging, this became something that I've been really focused on in the last couple of months. So I've been really focusing on this. Actually, I didn't order a copy of Grey Wolf. There's another book out there as well called Escape from the Bunker by Harry Cooper, who is a World War II veteran. He's especially knowledgeable in U-boats and submarines and such. So those two books, Escape from the Bunker and Grey Wolf. Grey Wolf is by Gerard Williams, who I was hoping to have on the show today. Actually, I sent him and Harry both an email to have them as a guest on the show today to talk about this subject. However, I didn't get an email back from them. Apparently, Gerard didn't even get an email, so I guess it got lost in thin air in transit somewhere. I don't know what happened to that email, but Harry Cooper never replied. I haven't heard anything back from him yet. However, it would have been great to get them on the show, but without having a guest on or without confirmation, I was left to do the show myself and try to tackle as much information as I can. So I've tried to essentially combine all the important pieces of evidence and information that I've been able to gather together to share with you guys today, so that you can make your own decision based off of the information I present, as well as the information you already know or can find outside of this broadcast. And don't believe me, look it up for yourself, believe what you want to believe, but just take the information I give to you and do what you will with it. Like I said, this is a blue pill, red pill broadcast. You're going to have to choose for yourself what to believe. However, I believe I did come up with enough evidence here to have a good point, to present something very, very, very credible with a lot of evidence. So I'm looking forward to presenting that information to you guys. So without further ado, I'm going to go to the Wikipedia page because I want to show you guys the very first page of the Wikipedia page regarding Hitler's death. And I'm going to get this on screen for you guys. And just a quick mention here as well, next week we have Corey Washington. He has the show The Average Laborator on the Truth Broadcast Network. He'll be joining the show for an interview as well. The next week, there will be SOS, Secrets of Sudbury. This is that Sudbury broadcast about the city that I live in that I was telling you guys about that I was going to do. And following that, we have an interview with Vinnie Eastwood. Definitely an awesome character, so I'm looking forward to that, to showing you guys that interview. But aside from that, I'm going to get this Wikipedia page up, just so you guys can see what our children are being taught in their history books. Alright, so, death of Hitler. There we go. Adolf Hitler committed, the first line here, folks, remember this. Adolf Hitler committed suicide by gunshot on 30th April 1945 in the Führer Bunker in Berlin. His wife, Eva Braun, committed suicide with him by ingesting cyanide. That afternoon, in accordance with Hitler's prior instructions, their remains were carried up the stairs through the bunker's emergency exit, doused in petrol, and set alight in the Reich Chancellery garden outside the bunker. Now, I want to point out here that what exists in that exact garden now? Why, a children's playground. What else? After they exhumed the remains that were found in this burial, this shallow burial site, they built a children's playground on it so that they could forget about the whole ordeal. So I don't think they chose a proper thing to build on top of this burial site, but I mean, I didn't make that decision, obviously, so that's just something I wanted to point out, which Wikipedia will fail to do. Records in the Soviet archive show that their burnt remains were recovered and interred in successive locations until 1970, when they were again exhumed, cremated, and the ashes scattered. So that's important to point out there, that they scattered the ashes after they re-exhumed the bodies, burned them again, because they had minor burning when they were first exhumed. Then the Russians apparently dug them up and burned them again and scattered the ashes around. Now, the evidence of the body that they had, the Soviets had a blood-soaked sofa in their evidence, as well as a portion of the skull with a bullet hole in it, which they claimed was Hitler's, a portion of his skull that proved that he committed suicide with a bullet to the head. And there's also a jaw piece as well that they have in evidence. Now, they've had this evidence under a lock and key for quite some time now, and there's some damning evidence now proving that those are not the remains of Adolf Hitler, which I will show you. But first, before this, the history books are writing that he died on the 30th of April, 1945 from suicide in his bunker. Now, you'll read this in pretty much any history book you find on the matter, on the war, which is interesting to point out. However, I did want to say that they say that he killed himself. This is the Russian portrayal of the story, that they found his body, etc., etc. And now there's images of the Russians with the apparent body of Hitler, because they claim that they found his body right away and pulled it out of the bunker. And it was not burned outside, that they had the body. They took pictures of this, and that was published in the Russian media throughout the world, and other countries started picking up on this story as well, that they found the body of Hitler. Now, the image of all these Russian soldiers, Soviet soldiers, with the body of Hitler, that person on the ground was not Hitler. It was proven that it was not Hitler, that it was excitement. They took a picture and it got out to the media, and then everybody started claiming that Hitler was dead. And then they used that image in the first days to say that this was the body of Hitler, even though it was not the body of Hitler. And it was a person that looked similar to Hitler, but definitely was not they did testing on it. They did, facial recognition and everything. And it was definitely proven that absolutely it was not Hitler, which I firmly believe. But what's interesting to note is the next day, May 1st, the day after they apparently find him committing suicide in the bunker, here's what the Germans said about what happened. The Wannecke report, which was on the May 1st on the radio all throughout Germany, announced on German radio that Hitler died a soldier's death. He died in battle, fighting. And that was announced on the radio by the Germans. So you have the Russians saying he committed suicide. You have the Germans saying that he died a soldier's death, that he died fighting till the end. You can find the radio broadcast online for that. So you have two different accounts of his death. Now, another very interesting thing to point out is all throughout this, even in 1945, Stalin claimed that Hitler was not dead. He likely escaped to Argentina. Now, we'll find out why he claimed that in a little bit. So that's kind of the reports, the early reports about where he was, what happened to him, etc., etc. So there is a few videos I got to show you now. And the first is on the search for Hitler. I'm going to show you a clip here. And I will give the sources for the clips, especially at the end of the broadcast. I'm going to be giving you guys some clips to check out, some further research on this matter if you want to look up more information on this, because I can only compress so much information in one broadcast here, and the rest will have to be up to you guys. So, here we go. Here is a clip on the search for Hitler.
Patrick Burnside, researcher and author of the book Hitler Escapes, has posed many questions about the investigation of Hitler's death.
Cualquier situación policial de un evento donde hay un suicidio, donde hay una muerte, se investiga. En este caso no se investigó. Se investigó menos de cualquier evento de cualquier nación, de cualquier policía del mundo. Cioè non si aprì un espediente, si incaricò un jovencito che in sua epoca fu il maggior Trevor Roper, che era un recién neolaureato in storia, di investigare bonariamente la morte di Hitler, perché da todo lado si decía che Hitler non aveva morto e si aveva scappato, da todo lado, fuera francese, fuera russo, fuera cualquier nazione belligerante, dico la suya.
In a meeting between Stalin and American Secretary of State James Burns a few weeks later, after the war ended, Stalin said, almost certainly, Hitler escaped to Argentina.
So what's interesting to point out here is that Stalin claimed that Hitler was not dead, even though the Russians had the evidence and they had all that stuff saying that they found his body, they had the remains, and they had all this evidence claiming that he committed suicide. Stalin still said Hitler was not dead, he likely escaped. And he wasn't the only figurehead that was claiming this at the same time. So there's that. Now, it's really hard to say where to go with this, which direction to take. I do have a few directions I need to branch out to, but it all joins together in the end, I assure you. So let's talk about the evidence. So we have a portion of Hitler's skull, which is claimed to be Hitler's skull by the Russians. We have a blood-soaked sofa with a bit of blood on it. And we have a jaw piece. So let's check out the evidence and let's see what we get out of that. Now, this here is a portion from a Mystery Quest episode, believe it or not. Mystery Quest covered this this subject and tried to determine information about Hitler's death to see if whether or not the stories were true, as well as they gained access. A scientific team gained access to the evidence in Russia for the History Channel to present on Mystery Quest. So they were allowed to go in and do some testing on these pieces of evidence. Forensic testing, by the way, not just a couple people just doing whatever. And this is the actual tests here. And I think you guys are going to be shocked with what you find out.
Now, the analysis of the science team will be vital in determining whether the rest of the Russian account is true. Dr. Nick Bellantoni doesn't think the skull the Russians say is Hitler's is really his. He says the areas where the skull plates come together indicate the skull belongs to someone much younger than Hitler would have been at the time of his death, and may even belong to a female. The team was able to extract something called allosomal DNA from the skull and blood evidence. This reveals a person's gender.
In females, there are two sex chromosomes of the X variety. A male has one X and one Y as his sex chromosomes. The red boxes tell us what the computer says is there.
First, the team looks at the DNA results from blood on the sofa.
The blood sample contains predominantly male DNA.
So the blood on the sofa came from a man. But whether it actually belongs to Hitler can't be proven without a DNA sample from a relative. While Hitler has living relatives in the U.S., they did not respond to inquiries from Mystery Quest. The team turns to the DNA result from the skull.
So the sample, which came from the skull, has only a female signature in it. And so we think that's come from a woman.
So you're saying the bone fragment came
from the bone fragment,
a woman, a female.
The skull of a female.
Wow. And you're absolutely positive about this?
As sure as we can be.
Wow.
Mystery Quest has uncovered groundbreaking new evidence that calls into question the historical account of the death of Adolf Hitler. The expedition team, using 3D animation, proved that the eyewitness accounts historians used are unreliable and probably wrong. The science team gained access to the skull Russia has long claimed is definitive proof Hitler did die in his bunker, and discovered it is in fact a woman's.
This is very exciting.
Very exciting.
These astonishing facts may open a whole new chapter in history.
What happened the day the notorious Nazi dictator Adolf Hitler died? Over 60 years later, the mystery lives on. Hitler's only remains are his jawbone and his skull, both kept in an archive in Russia. But American archaeologist Nick Bellantoni and geneticist Linda Strasbaugh say the skull actually belongs to a woman under 40 years old.
You know, Hitler was a middle-sized male, and usually males in our species are bigger, more robust, the bone is thicker. This bone, it was very small, very fragile, and very thin in terms of the plate. And I remember looking at it initially and I saying, gee, more like a woman or a small man, somebody I would expect to be 20 to 40 years of age. And Hitler was 56 years old when he died.
The traditional version of his death says Hitler and the love of his life and new bride, Eva Braun, committed suicide on April 30th, 1945. The dictator is said to have taken a pill and shot himself in the head. After being discovered, Hitler's and Braun's bodies were burnt. Later, a jawbone and then a skull were found and claimed to have belonged to the dictator. Nick isn't the only one saying the skull kept in Moscow has nothing to do with Hitler. His colleague Linda carried out DNA testing on pieces that Nick somehow managed to bring to the U.S. from Russia.
We had two moments that were eureka moments. The first was when we actually were able to get DNA. The second was when we saw the profile, because then it was clear to us that that was not the skull of a man.
A soldier working near the crater finds this bone, and it's got a bullet hole and it's burnt. And I think an assumption was made, this must be Hitler.
Scientists and hungry minds all over the globe are pushing to reveal the truth behind Hitler's death. And even though one of the most infamous figures in world history has long been gone, the truth is still out there, and answers to the mystery are yet to be discovered. Anastasia Churkina, RT, Mansfield, Connecticut.
So it seems like that is forensic evidence right there, proving that it was a woman's skull and not a man's skull. And that, folks, is forensic evidence. It's not like the assumption, they made in the first place, that it was a Hitler's skull with a bullet hole through it. That was an assumption. Like like the archaeologist said, from Connecticut. And these tests were done at the University of Connecticut to determine, that's where the DNA tests were done. So that this is not assumption. They actually had pieces of the skull. They brought it back. They did the DNA test. They not only proved it. They not only found DNA, but they also were able to profile it and find out that it was a woman's skull. So that rules out that evidence right there, that that was Hitler's body there. And keep in mind that the captured Nazis that the Soviets had, that they were apparently interrogating, which I believe they were some of, I believe there was a faction of the Soviet group that was just not aware of this, that weren't privy to the information that he could have escaped or that he did escape, absolutely. These people were put in charge to, you know, interrogate these Nazi prisoners. So they were interrogating these Nazi prisoners, and there's lots of videos from this. You could find it all over the net, all over YouTube, where these Nazi soldiers are saying that they brought out Hitler's body and burned him in the back and buried him, and they were the ones who did it. Now, they never seen the bodies. They were wrapped up. They didn't bother to look at the bodies. They were wrapped up in blankets, and they brought them out. So nobody saw the body of Hitler. I never saw the body of Hitler. You never saw the body of Hitler either. So how could you be so sure that that was Hitler's body? Especially now that we have forensic evidence saying that it was not. So there you go. For anybody out there who thinks that he killed himself in the bunker, there's a lot of evidence going to be thrown at you for the rest of this broadcast that's going to make you really think about where and what happened to Adolf Hitler. And I have witness testimony to show you guys. I have a lot of things to show you guys that's going to be quite interesting. So the broadcast did crash there for a second. I do apologize. That happens sometimes with the broadcasts I do, especially in regards to sensitive information like this. But it's expected, I guess. They don't like people talking about this stuff. But in any event, I wanted to discuss something. So after we discover that the body of Hitler was not there, that it was not Hitler's body, we must move to the next thing. And the jawbone, by the way, is another interesting piece of evidence that people claim is proof that it was Hitler and all this stuff. However, they looked, when they found the jawbone, they looked for Hitler's dentist to find him to be able to determine if it was absolutely Hitler's teeth and jawbone. Now, Hitler's dentist escaped as well with thousands of other Nazis. Thousands of Nazis escaped, not just a few. This is thousands, hundreds of thousands, believe it or not. So Hitler's dentist was one of them, and I'm sure that Hitler's doctor was another one, because Hitler can't leave the country without his doctor and his dentist. So what did they do? They went to find the next best person who could guarantee that this evidence was Hitler's body so they could lay the issue to rest, and that was Hitler's dentist's assistant. Now, I mean, she was going by eye, I guess, hearsay, just, yes, I've worked on him before. I've seen an interview with her, and she said, yes, I've worked on him before, and this looks like his teeth. And because of that, that's a whole nother operation, if you will, to make it look like he died. Because you have the Russians' account, you have the Germans' account saying he died fighting, you have all these different accounts. Now, why would that be happening? Why would all this confusion be happening when the most wanted man in the world is gone? Well, there's a reason for it, which we'll find out. So I'm going to show you guys another clip here, and this is important here to discuss. Many of you are familiar with Project Paperclip. Now, Project Paperclip essentially was an operation by the CIA where they allowed Nazi scientists and top-ranking Nazi officials to escape the Nuremberg trials, escape any penalties whatsoever for their involvement with what happened, with what the evidence that they were discovering there, and they let them walk, essentially. They let them assume new identities or keep their same identities and work under covert programs in America and other parts in the world, not just America. And what most people don't realize as well is it's underreported, I guess you could say, is that the Soviets also had their pick at these Nazi scientists. It wasn't just America. The Soviets also had their pick at these Nazi scientists, and that whole paperclip ordeal allowed these countries to gain top scientists because they were interested in Nazi technology. The Nazi technology at the time was severely advanced, more advanced than any other country in the world at the time, and these countries wanted to exploit that and gain control of the wisdom and the testing and the technology that they had. So they brought these Nazis over, and they did not have any penalties whatsoever. Paperclip covered them in that aspect. So when you have these agencies doing that, letting these people live and escape war crimes, there's an agenda there, definitely. And then you have the same country saying that Hitler's dead, even though the evidence does not support that. So there's definitely a hidden agenda going on here, and it's up to us to figure that out. Otherwise, we'll never know. And knowing is only half the battle, folks. So I'm going to show you guys another clip here, a brief clip
from Gottlieb something very important. Dr. Gottlieb used Nazi scientists and their state-of-the-art mind-control techniques that had been perfected in concentration camps using victims of the Holocaust. General Dwight D. Eisenhower gave his personal approval to exploit the work and research of the Nazis in the death camps. The German doctors were brought to the U.S. and went to work for Project Paperclip. These men were insulated against war crimes charges. The Nuremberg prosecutors were shocked that the U.S. authorities were using German doctors despite their criminal past. Under the leadership of Dr. Strughold, 34 scientists accepted contracts from Project Paperclip and were moved to Randolph Air Force Base in San Antonio, Texas. These personalities began to work on human radiation studies, aviation medicine, microwave technology, and MKUltra mind control experiments. The authorization to hire these Nazi scientists came directly from the Joint Chiefs of Staff. The top military brass stated that they wished to exploit these rare minds. Operation Paperclip eventually recruited 9,000 Nazi scientists and technicians to help the U.S. destroy the USSR. Some of these scientists were known as programmers, people skilled in the art of breaking down and controlling the human mind.
So that's just a short clip about Project Paperclip with actual footage of these Nazis being allowed into America at their new jobs, Von Braun, his rocket program, all that stuff. Plus, anybody who's watched my documentary, New World Order Domino Effect, I also speak about Joseph Mengele working in Canada, because there's evidence supporting that as well. Definitely interesting stuff that these people got away from such severe war crimes and allowed to live and continue and reap rewards and benefits for that. That's definitely something to point out there. So that's one thing. So if these agencies are allowing Nazis over into their country without anything, then there had to have been evidence of other people doing the same thing in other parts of the world, or the Nazis escaping without anybody chasing after them and going after them. Now, one interesting point to point out is Mossad, Israeli intelligence, definitely went after some of these Nazis and made sure to brutally murder them when they were caught. There's all sorts of things that happened, but out of the Axis powers, you have Japan, and you have Italy, and you have Germany. Now, in Italy, it's very apparent what happened to Mussolini. He was hung with his wife out in a public display and murdered in front of everybody. And that's on video. That's all over YouTube. I'm not going to play the video here, but you could find it yourself if you look for it. So that's what happened to that fascist dictator. Now, Japan, he tried to commit suicide. Their leader tried to commit suicide, failed, and as a result of that, he was captured and rehabilitated back to health, so we know that he didn't escape. And we know that Mussolini didn't escape. But Hitler, on the other hand, we have all this faulty evidence that's being thrown at us and in our history books that is lies. So that's why I really wanted to look into this too, to try to figure out what happened. Now, we have to ask ourselves, what did Hitler do? How did he escape? Where did he go? These are important questions now, knowing the information I presented to you, which is where we're going to go. We have to figure out how he escaped. And there was a news report, actually, from a Nazi pilot. His name was Captain Peter Baumgart. And I couldn't find the clip. I mean, I could find it really quickly right now, but I do just want to explain it to you. Look it up for yourself if you have the time. Captain Peter Baumgart, Baumgart. He was a German pilot, and he claims that he flew Hitler to Denmark on April 28th, which is a couple days before they claim that he killed himself, and 3 days before the Nazis claim that he died a soldier's death. So you have this pilot saying that he flew him to Denmark, and that is the, when you really start looking into this, that seems to be what, where everything is lying, or where everything is pointing to, is that this flight to Denmark, and then he escaped from U-boat after that. Now, I'll get into that in a moment, but who was with him? Obviously, Eva Braun was with him, as well his finance minister was with him as well. So that's very important, that the Nazi Minister of Finance, Martin Bormann, escaped as well with Hitler. Now, why would Hitler want to bring his Minister of Finance with him to escape Germany? Well, it's likely so that he could continue his finances, because you have to look at all the connections here, people. The connections between the Nazis and the Americans during World War II is absurd. What was happening is Americans were essentially supplying the Nazis with a lot of their materials for the war, and in turn the Germans were using it to kill the Americans. So the Americans were killing themselves for profit. And that's what war is all about. You control both sides of the war. On each side of the river is a bank. And that's a reason for that, because the cash flows down that river, and on each side there has to be a bank. Of course, that's the way it works. It's all subliminal occult knowledge right there that goes back to maritime admiralty law and all that baloney. So that's very important to point out here. So you have this pilot who claims he flew Hitler to Denmark, and then there's a couple U-boats that arrived on the shores of Argentina and surrendered themselves. Now there's a lot of activity on the coast there between Argentina as well as Antarctica. There was a lot of channel U-boat activity between there. Now these U-boats are numbered. There's U-boat number 530, and there was U-boat 977. And U-boat 530 arrived on the Argentinian shores in July 1945, and U-boat 977 arrived in August. So just a month apart there, two U-boats, which were Führer U-boats, arrived in Argentina and surrendered themselves suspiciously, I would say. Now, that proves that these U-boats escaped, and there's reports of up to 200 U-boats also escaped the war and just vanished. A lot of them were sank, a lot of them were later discovered as sank or destroyed or missing. There was a lot of these U-boats were later on to be found or reported for, but there is still, and still to this day, lots that are just missing. Nobody knows what happened to them. They're unaccountable, so that's very questionable. They did have a lot of U-boat activity there. And we're going to get into the Antarctica aspect later on in the episode towards the end, because that's very important in the grand scheme of this whole thing. So I definitely need to point that out. Now, why Argentina? That's got to be your next question. Why would Hitler want to go to Argentina? And I'm sure a lot of you listeners out there have heard that before, that Hitler escaped to Argentina. Because, I mean, after speaking with this with a few friends, they even said, let me guess, he escaped to Argentina. Like they, and then they roll their eyes about it almost. You know, a couple of my friends did that because they just didn't know about all this information that I'm going to present them. That's the thing, right? You hear about it and then you think it's just some conspiracy theory, and you throw it out, you throw it away without even thinking about it or doing your own research. And that's all it takes. I mean, I was in that same predicament. before all this. You know, I was like, okay, yeah, he, as I stated at the beginning of the broadcast, I believed at first that he did kill himself in the bunker, and I thought in no way that he could have survived or escaped or anything like that until I did the research. And that's what it takes in any situation. If you want to be informed about something, it's up to you to inform yourself. You can have sources of information, but ultimately it's up to you to decide. And that's why this broadcast is the Blue Pill, Red Pill broadcast. So I had to point that out again. So in Denmark, this pilot dropped off also General Romer and his wife, Eva Braun, and Baumgart disappeared in the 50s. The pilot that apparently dropped off Hitler after reporting these stories and stuff just vanished off the face of the earth. Nobody has heard from him since. He just disappeared. MIA, whatever you want to call it, or he was killed off so that he would stop talking about this. That's my opinion. That's what I personally believe. Now, I kind of getting off track here. I got to go back for a moment to talk about the connections between the U.S. and the Nazi Party, which are very, very profound. You also have Prescott Bush, George Bush's grandfather. He was also funding both sides of the war. He had investments in Nazi Germany. Some of the biggest companies as well that we know even today were active in the in World War II, including IBM. IBM was essentially the ones who gave the Nazis their tracking technology to track all the prisoners in the concentration camps, to keep their numbers, to keep track of it, because the Nazis did keep really good records. And IBM is a big help to that. Also, Ford Motors. If you look at Henry Ford, he was honored by the Nazi Party, actually. So you have this massive connection. There's a lot of Americans that are actual Nazis. They're Nazi supporters. They love it. They've always been into that. Some of the monarchy are really into Nazism. So you have all this stuff. So why would they be supporting Nazis? That's the question, right? But other companies, ITT, as well as Tyson Krupp, which is still in existence today, steel manufacturing company, also mechanical technologies like elevators and stuff. That's what they're big for. Siemens as well. There's all sorts of companies, tons of companies that the Nazis and the Americans were kind of both gaining profits from the war. So that's what happens during a war, is there's mass profits to be made, and that's the bottom line right there. So again, we have to ask ourselves, why Argentina? Well, the reason why is because there was a massive amount of Nazis in Argentina. There was actually quite a bit of support for the Nazi Party, which came from Argentina, which we're going to investigate right now. I would say, I'm going to play this clip first, because this is about the Eichhorn family. And they were definite supporters of the Nazi Party. So I'm going to play this clip for you guys.
Argentina, La Falda, in a province of Córdoba. Pioneers who came here in the end of 1800 built this village. One of the most significant places of the provinces was the Eden Hotel, a beautiful site with international prestige.
En esa época, el Eden Hotel recibió a reyes, presidentes, Einstein. Era conocido internacionalmente por el prestigio que tenía.
La Falda era un búnker nazi, eso era obvio. Cada vez que Alemania ganaba algún país o tenía alguna victoria, había fiesta y aparte que se festejaba fuertemente en el Hotel Eden.
The hotel owners were Walter and Ida Eichhorn. They were supporters of the Nationalist Socialist Party in Germany and personal friends of Adolf Hitler.
Esta gente se carteaba con el Führer. Y periódicamente esta gente viajaba a Alemania. Por lo menos dos veces al año iba a Alemania. ¿A qué iban? No le podría decir. Hay gente que dice que iban a darle dinero para la campaña.
No hay ninguna persona que haya sido más allegada y afín a Hitler que ellos dos. O sea, había una relación ahí muy, muy loca, o sea, muy, muy profunda, y a mí no me cabe ninguna duda que Hitler pudo llegar a donde llegó gracias al apoyo de ellos.
Hitler le mandó de regalo un Mercedes-Benz, que fue el primer Mercedes-Benz que vino a la Argentina. Un regalo personal de Adolfo Hitler a la señora Ida Eichhorn.
So this is a video here that shows just how deeply rooted the German infrastructure was in Argentina. This is actually a war film, an official war film that was put out, which explains it all, how the German influence was massive there. A lot of the business infrastructure, the banking infrastructure, everything really was linked to Germany. So the Germans definitely had a huge root, I guess you could say, in this area of the world, in Argentina. And very interesting connections here in this video are made to some major companies that a lot of them still exist today. If you look at some of the names that are going to be showing up here, it's very interesting. I mean, I can't translate this video, is one thing. I don't speak Argentinian, but here we go, Bayer. It's a pharmaceutical company, I believe, or Bayer, I'm not sure how you pronounce that. But there is a lot of connections here that you'll see, including Siemens and Tyson Krupp, which is still a current steel manufacturer. They do elevators and electronics using steel and etc. Industrial products as well. So there is a lot of connections here. There's Siemens there. So they had a lot of money invested there. There's a lot of connections between Argentina and Nazi Germany. And they had a massive, massive support there in Argentina. There's a lot of support for the Nazis. And there's the Tyson factory, which still exists today. Actually, I've seen a vehicle drive by just today in my city, Tyson, right on the door. It's actually Tyson Krupp now. Here we go. That was very curious. If you looked at that, that was a CIA, stalker in CIA, it said. So that's very interesting right there. Stalker in CIA. Here's a replay. I mean, I don't really think that is the actual CIA because it wasn't really formed till after this point. However, it is interesting. And here we have the Argentinian Nazis. Nazis in Argentina by the thousands during World War II. And here's the proof.
And here you'll notice the swastikas, the armbands. They are wearing Nazi uniforms. And these are Argentinian soldiers that are Nazis. So it's no wonder that a high-ranking Nazi officer would feel safe in Argentina. And in which year was it? There was a massive march in Argentina. It was a Nazi march. This is it. This is scenes from it. And it's interesting to point out that the Argentinians had, I wrote it down here, you just have to let me find it for a moment. The Argentinians had 30,000 Nazi members in the Patagonian sovereign state. The Patagonian was actually its own sovereign state that was a Nazi state in Argentina. And they had 30,000 members, which is where that hotel which you just saw was from. And this is why Hitler would be so welcome there. One thing I want to point out as well, before I get to the witnesses in Argentina that saw Hitler, I'm going to show you guys some FBI documents. And to do that, I'm going to need to get the website up here. So you'll have to give me a moment. Here we go. Right on. Switch screen. So this is the official FBI website. Anybody can go to this website if you want. The link, the URL is vault.fbi.gov/Adolf-Hitler. Hit enter, you'll get this page. And these are the documents that the FBI have. And it says right here on the FBI records, Adolf Hitler, 1889 to 1945, was leader of the National Socialist Nazi Party and Chancellor of Germany from 33 to 45. He led that country into World War II in 1939. The documents in this time file are in this file range from 1933 to 1947, but primarily fall either in 1933 or between 45 and 47. In 1933, the FBI investigated an assassination threat made against Hitler. In the aftermath of Germany's surrender in 1945, Western Allied forces suspected that Hitler had committed suicide but did not immediately find evidence of his death. At the time, it was feared that Hitler may have escaped in the closing days of the war, and searches were made to determine if he was still alive. FBI files indicate that the Bureau investigated some of the rumors of Hitler's survival. So the FBI believed he was still alive, otherwise they would not have invested money to search for him. So here are the documents. This one here is partially redacted. I'll get it on screen here. And as you can see, they don't want us finding out all the information here. It is partially redacted. I'll try to view this full screen because, I mean, it's going to be really hard to read this from here. There we go, zoom. All right, so I'm going to read a bit of this document. And this document is pretty lengthy, so I'm only going to read a partial of it. Hollywood, California reported to a blank on the city deke of the Los Angeles Examiner newspaper that upon his leaving the Melody Lane restaurant at Hollywood and Vine on about July 28, 1945, he met a friend of his who at the time was engaged in a conversation with an individual who later identified himself as blank. Blank, friend whose identity he does not wish to disclose because of reasons that will later be explained, remarked to blank that he would like to have him meet blank as it was quite evident that blank problem on his mind. So essentially what they're saying is this person was scared to release this information, but he did, ended up in an FBI report. Was one of four men who met Hitler and his party when they landed from two submarines in Argentina approximately 2.5 weeks after the fall of Berlin. Blank continued that the first sub came close to shore about 11 p.m. after it had been signaled that it was safe to land and a doctor and several men disembarked. Now this is where the stories of where Hitler was met on the beach by men with horses. They gathered their supplies and they went into the valley. They traveled pretty far so that they could get away into solitude, which is how he lived the rest of his life. Now, another doctor and several more men, making the whole party arriving by submarine approximately 50. So 50 were aboard. By prearranged plan with six top Argentina officials. So the Argentine officials knew that, and actually they are releasing documents about this now. There is a couple films that are investigating that that I'm aware of that will be going through this newly released paperwork from the Argentine archives. But so I know that there will be revelations coming out in the future, further revelations about this topic. So keep your eyes out for that. So here's the pack horses. We're waiting for them, the group. And by daylight, all supplies were loaded on the horses. An all-day trip inland toward the foothills of the southern Andes was started. At dusk, the party arrived at the ranch where Hitler and his party, according to Blank, are now in hiding. So these are some of the reports of Hitler being seen by people, being witnessed by people. The FBI was following up and just documenting the reports that they got. And as you can see, whose name is on these? J. Edgar Hoover. J. Edgar Hoover was essentially personally overseeing these reports of Hitler coming in, and we all know how he handled the JFK assassination. So anybody with a brain on their shoulders would be able to figure out that this guy here, J. Edgar Hoover, is, as Vinnie Eastwood puts it, one of the kings of scumbaggery. So definitely questionable, but I mean, these documents are severely redacted to hide identities, locations, any critical evidence that would lead somebody to find the treasure at the bottom of the rainbow, essentially, or at the bottom of the rabbit hole. Now, some of these documents are severely redacted, blacked right out. You can't read nothing on the documents, but there is a lot of information in these FBI reports. These are pretty big files. I'm not going to go through them all. I'll leave you guys to that if you want to look into this further at another time. I just wanted to show you that these FBI files do in fact exist, and the FBI was actively searching for Adolf Hitler after the war. So I do believe as well that they did send agents to Argentina to look around, but I'm sure they had an agenda to not say anything about it when they came back. These reports here were just reporting on the sightings, some of the claims, etc. I believe there is a bit of discussion about the agents going there, but if they did find anything and it was made public, they definitely didn't make it very public because it's not in our history books. I mean, we still are taught that he killed himself in the bunker, which is a falsity. So that's very important to point out, that the FBI were looking into this guy, into his disappearance as well. And for quite some time after his death, I might add. So I'm going to show you guys also a video clip, as well as this is the credit for a couple of the videos.
Catalina Gamero was one of the workers in the Hotel Eden who worked for the Eichhorns since she was an adolescent. She told us that she served for 3 days a very special guest of the Eichhorn couple, Adolf Hitler. This was during
1947.
Additional to Gamero's testimony, there is the testimonial of Hernan Ancin, who is a carpenter of Antipa Velic, a Nazi leader in Croatia, who lived in Mar del Plata, Argentina, during the 1950s.
Hitler. Debe haber sido fines del 53.
¿Y en qué circunstancias?
Vino ahí, venía.
¿A dónde?
Al edificio a hablar con Pavelic. Venía caminando con los tres guardaespaldas y la señora. Prácticamente lo traían caminando, ¿no? Que apenas caminaba él.
Tenía la misma pinta.
La misma, de blanco, pelo corto, tipo militar, cortado, sin bigote. Bueno, ahí estuve yo conversando, me invitaron a sentarme en la mesa, me convidó la señora de Pavelic con un café. Hitler estaba tomando café con alguna bebida más con Pavelic. Y yo ahí le conté. Entonces, Pavelic le dice a Hitler, es el carpintero, dice que me hace la carpintería en el edificio. Entonces Hitler me miró y me hizo una reverencia así, en esta forma. Un saludo, ¿no? Más cerca de él. Estuve tomando café, inclusive.
¿Usted está convencido que era
Hitler? Sí.
The testimonial we saw asked the question, if Hitler understood the end of the war was approaching, Did he decide to leave the country? Patrick Burnside is sure that Hitler escaped to South America thanks to the German infrastructure, who received the permission and facilities of Argentinian General Juan Perón.
Hubo un preparativo en los años 45 para crear un lugar seguro manejado por a sueldos de los servicios secretos alemanes, crear un hábitat favorable por un eventual desenlace no favorable a Hitler. Pero los documentos liberados, docenas, indican que Hitler y su señora, llamámosla así, llegó a la Argentina con dos subotes, una noche de mediados de julio de 1945.
No, no, pero él de Maurín murió en Argentina, eso yo lo apuesto. Porque él daba vuelta acá en la Argentina, él no se fue de acá. Y él no murió en Alemania tampoco.
Todo indica que hubo años vivido en lugar apacible, rodeados de seguridad, de bosques impenetrables, alejado dalla civilizzazione, e tranquillo, vivió tranquillo.
As we saw from testimonials of different researchers, Adolf Hitler died a natural death in Argentina sometime during the 60s. Until now, no one knows where he's buried.
Lo de Trevor Roper, The Last Day, tendría que ser The Last Year of Hitler en Patagonia, no Los Últimos Días en Berlín.
Revealed will expose for the first time personal accounts and original data that supports the possibility of the world's most evil man spending his final years in utter tranquility in Argentina.
And this is the documentary here, Revealed, Hitler in Argentina. And that documentary is expected to be released in May 2014. And that promo video that you just watched, or a clip from it anyways, it wasn't the whole promo video, but that was a clip from it, that was released a couple years ago, I believe in 2012. So it has taken quite some time for this film to surface itself. And it was made by a couple Israeli filmmakers, which is interesting. But they did go there and they interviewed these witnesses and tried to piece it all together, and they also are the ones who were getting documents that were released from the Argentinian government. So I believe those documents will probably be in the documentary when it is finally released, and I'm really looking forward to that film because it's the first of its kind in my opinion. I haven't seen any films relating to anything like that, so that's definitely important to point out, and I did want to credit that source, Revealed, Hitler in Argentina. It's looking like it's going to be a good film for sure. Now, in Argentina, he would have been safe. As you've seen, he had associates there. They had a lot of support for the Nazis there. And if you look on the map, I should bring one up on the screen here, actually. I'll do that off to the side here. But if you look at a map, Argentina is strategically located, essentially. It's not really near much except Antarctica, the tip of it, which is another topic we're going to get into in a minute there. Definitely needs to be discussed. So, here we have it. Argentina right here. And it doesn't show Antarctica. But Antarctica is down here. There's a strip of islands here, which includes the Falkland Islands, which there was a war there in 1982. The Argentinians went there to try to take it over from British Crown, and there was a battle that ensued. It wasn't a major war, a huge world war or anything like that, but there was some casualties, and that's quite interesting that there was a war there. But there's a strip of islands here that go right down to the tip of Antarctica. And a lot of maps actually, curiously, don't show Antarctica. And I think there's a reason for that, which I'll explain in a moment, momentarily rather. It's not even listed on here. It is a continent, one of the entire continents on the Earth is not on a lot of maps. So you have to ask yourself, why? Here we go. This one here shows it. So I'll get this one. This one's a bit more precise and accurate. I mean, I got a big map behind me, but I'm not going to go back there. It'll be hard for you guys to see. This is a lot easier here. But here you go. Here's the tip of Argentina. There's a strip of islands here. There's also this tip that comes out from Antarctica here, almost connecting Argentina with Antarctica. This whole zone here. And this is where the U-boat activity was. There was tons of U-boat activity found in here. Nazi U-boats. U-boat number 530 and 977 surrendered themselves to the shores of Argentina here, apparently after being in this region for some time. And that was after the war. So that's very important to point out as well. That's as far as I can zoom in to show you guys that there's not too much of a space there between those two. Perfect area for that. So why would the Nazis be so concentrated in this area? That's another question you must be asking yourself, is why that area? And there's a good reason for it, which happened even before the war, which I'll show you. But first I want to get an author. I found a portion of an interview of Gerard Williams. I wanted to have him on the show here, but I did find a news clip of him speaking and presenting some of the information about Hitler being in Argentina. Now, he has a book called Grey Wolf. I would encourage anybody out there to get a copy of that book if you want to read more about this subject. I'm definitely going to be ordering a copy of that book from Gerard in the next couple weeks. I was speaking to Gerard earlier today, and I definitely think he's, definitely a scholar on this subject. He knows a lot about what he's talking about. He's dedicated a lot of his time into researching this subject. So I would consider Gerard to be an expert on this. He also did a couple good interviews, which you can find on YouTube if you want to look it up. He's a credible source, in my opinion, for this kind of information. So definitely check out Gerard Williams and his book, Grey Wolf. Definitely...
As we got into it, the more times we visited Argentina, the more people we met in Argentina, the more fires we discovered, the more newspaper reports we looked at from the time, it became pretty obvious that the death in the bunker was nothing but, well, fiction. Or maybe somebody died in the bunker, but it wasn't Adolf Hitler.
Or is it that that's what a lot of people would have liked to have believed, and that's how they would have liked the history to be written? And we remember how Hugh Trevor Roper was duped by the Hitler
diaries. I have no idea why Hugh Trevor Roper was actually chosen by the Secret Services to do the death of Hitler. I mean, the guy was an Oxford academic. He had been listening to radio inserts all war. And yet they put him into Germany in Berlin to write the definitive intelligence report on the death of Hitler. Why they didn't put Scotland Yard in, or some of the best detectives of our time, I don't know.
However, I mean, there are other historians, Alan Bullock, of course, Hitler's biographer, and then more recently Sir Ian Kershaw, who say, look, the evidence that Hitler committed suicide and then his body in Eva Braun's was burnt, either as a result of deliberate action or by shell fire, that the evidence is there. I mean, what weight of evidence have you got now to actually balance that argument?
I think it's likely that somebody died in the bunker, but I don't think it was Hitler. We have the testimony from a Warsaw court of the pilot who flew them out. He went to court in 1947, gave details of who he'd flown out, where he'd flown from, and where he flew them to. The judge in Warsaw at the time thought, you really are joking, you have to be, so sent him away for psychological testing. 6 months later, they brought him back into court. He said exactly the same thing. He was extremely detailed. We have the testimony from an SS officer on the ground in Denmark who saw the plane arrive and Hitler and Eva Braun get out with other passengers. We have what I think is an overwhelming amount of evidence that shows that Adolf Hitler survived, got to Argentina. His daughter later joined them there.
Now, there is the interesting fact, the daughter, and therefore you've got DNA evidence. Has that actually been pursued to try and provide some concrete evidence that might stand up in a criminal trial, for instance?
I think, well, there can't be any criminal trial. I mean, Hitler was never even accused of anything. He was dead. Well,
although he was the world's greatest criminal.
I know, really. I think the two daughters are still alive. One was born in Argentina at the end of 1945, and one was born in Germany, or possibly Italy, in 1938, and came out to join them later. There are numerous reports that Eva Braun was pregnant in the bunker before they left. to try and go after these people, or to go after the children of these people. And over 30,000 Nazis and fascists escaped to Latin America after the war. I don't know whether it's really our job or my job. It's the history, you know, the children's sins.
If the evidence was there, why haven't the Nazi hunters, Wiesenthal and his like, actually gone down this trail before?
I think that's
because it's been so well hidden.
That's a really good question. You have to remember that Argentina was pretty much a fascist dictatorship until the early 80s.
Perón was supported, of course, by the Nazis.
Well, we have evidence, and it's presented in the book, that both Perón and Ava were Nazi spies from 1941 in the pay of Abwehr, the military intelligence organization of the Nazis. I don't know why people didn't go after them. One, he was dead, so I suppose, you know, why bother? And secondly, you know, it took almost 11 and a half years for the Americans to find bin Laden. And they knew he was alive, and they knew where he was. And, you know, it took them a long time to find him.
And would the argument be that even though he might be alive, it's more convenient for them to actually just establish the fact that he is dead?
I think a deal was done in 1944, early 1945, to get Martin Bormann, Adolf Hitler, and Gestapo and Müller out of Germany. And the deal was done with senior members of the American intelligence services and a very few industrialists who knew this was going on.
And I couldn't agree with that more. What he said there rings true in my mind, that the intelligence services knew that Hitler was alive, but they allowed him to live. As well as other Nazis, because of Paperclip and all those other connections that I've showed you guys, that is reason enough right there. So they continue they could continue to reap the benefits and the profits from that, which is why Martin Bormann, the Nazi finance minister, went with them. He had access to all the assets and all the money, and the Nazi Party was worth a lot of money, especially with all their investments in the military-industrial complex, exactly what Gerard said, the industries and stuff. Massive connections there. Massive. So you have all this. It's like this. Definitely working together, hand in hand. And it was a safe haven for Hitler to be in Argentina, especially being so close to Antarctica. Now, the next bit of information I'm going to present you this is a rabbit hole, put it that way. It's a rat's nest of information. There's so much disinformation put out there about this subject. It's very hard to figure out what's true and what's false. There's a lot of information to it, too. I could have done probably two separate two-hour broadcasts just on what I'm going to be presenting in the next little bit of time here. That's how thorough this rabbit hole is. And I assure you, it's not easy to figure out, but I tried to filter out all the baloney, all the misinformation, and all of the propaganda, essentially. I tried to filter it all out and present you guys the most least biased presentation that I possibly could in regards to the Antarctic subject. So, to start with this sequence, I need to show you guys a bit about something. I'll show you guys this first. This is a little bit about the history of Antarctica, and this is from a Russian documentary, which is half propaganda, half real, for reasons I'll explain later if I have the time. Hopefully I do. But this film is called Third Reich Operation UFO, and I guess I'll explain it a little bit here before I show you. Because I did trim out all of the UFO stuff that they talk about here, because, that's the subject right there that anybody who watched my New World Order Alien Agenda episode, it's banned now from YouTube. I had to take it down, otherwise I wouldn't be able to upload further broadcasts, so I was forced to delete that file from my YouTube account. Because I pressed on some very, very important information, and I think I presented a clear picture of what's going on there with the alien agenda, and they didn't like that one bit, so right away, taken down. I do have a copy of it. I'm going to try to get it on torrents or something so that the information can spread out there, because I think that was probably one of the best broadcasts I ever did, I think, just in regards to presenting information. And weeding out all of the misinformation and propaganda and lies and deceptions and fictional reality that they've created for us to, just haphazardly believe in and all that kind of stuff. So I trimmed out a lot of the UFO and the saucer stuff in regards to this. But in prior to World War II, just prior to World War II, a Nazi expedition was sent out to Antarctica to claim land there. And they did claim lots of land in Antarctica. The Nazis did claim quite a bit of land. And one of the portions of land was called Queen Maud Land. And I'm going to show you guys this before I show you the next video clip. This is an area called New Swabia. And I usually hate Wikipedia. I mean, Wikipedia has some good information, but a lot of it is just meant for lies. But this is, right here, you can see the Nazi flag. And this is, right here, this is the area of Antarctica that was claimed by the Nazis. And it's not only that place that was claimed by the Nazis, but tons. And here you go. There's the history of Antarctic expeditions. But these are all of the monuments right here claimed by the Nazis in Antarctica. That's a huge chunk right there. That's a lot of landmarks and landmasses that were named that still have these same names, some of them. So there's a connection. And this is the symbol of the expedition, 1938 to 1939, as I said, just prior to World War II. And they boarded the MS Schwaberlin. This is in 1938. This is one of the ships that transported people over there for this expedition. And there you go. The Deutsche Antarktische Expedition. So you can check out this Wikipedia page if you want. This landmass is called New Swabia. And it says right here, this is the... there it is. It's as a Norwegian dependent territory. New Swabia was explored by Germany in early 39 and named after that expedition ship, itself named after the German region of Swabia. And that wasn't the only place that the Nazis claimed, by the way. There was other places in Antarctica that they claimed. Now, look at that. There's Argentina. And there's a very close distance between them right there. So... let's talk about Antarctica. I'm going to show you a clip here about the history of Antarctica. It gives a little bit of history and also explains the Nazi expedition that I just showed you that claimed New Swabia, where they dropped Nazi flags. That's how they claimed territory. They dropped flags on the landmass to claim it's theirs.
В 1820 году ее открыли русские мореплаватели Беллинсгаузен и Лазарев. С тех пор этот загадочный континент по площади при Антарктида. В 1820 году ее открыли русские мореплаватели Беллинсгаузен и Лазарев. С тех пор этот загадочный континент, по площади превышающий Европу, как магнитом притягивает к себе исследователей. Однако отвесные, высотой в десятки метров ледяные берега долгое время делают материк неприступным. Еще целое столетие об Антарктиде почти ничего не известно. На карты нанесены лишь береговые линии. И вдруг к далекому и бесполезному ледяному континенту проявляет непонятный интерес Германия. На изучение Антарктиды выделены огромные средства.
В конце 30-х годов организованы две научно-исследовательских экспедиции. И это перед войной, готовой разродиться со дня на день.
С января 1939 года два самолета «Пассат» и «Борей», которые с помощью катапульт взлетают с борта Швабии, начинают разведку земли королевы Мод. За три недели летчики Люфтваффе с помощью металлических вымпелов со знаком свастики застолбили за Третьим Рейхом территорию величиной с Германию. Она получила название «Новая Швабия».
New Swabia. There we go. And what's interesting to point out is when the war ended in 1945, the Russians sent subs to Antarctica to search for a Nazi base because they heard that there was one there, that the Nazis went on an expedition there prior to World War II to set up a base for their more secret technology, as well as to have a safeguard in case Germany was invaded and they would face defeat and they would need to escape to somewhere safe. So a base apparently was set up in Antarctica beforehand. Now, finding evidence of this base is very hard. I dug for a long time to find definitive proof of this base. However, this Russian documentary seems to describe it quite a bit, and these come from documents. They claim that they have documents. I did find some documents, and I was reading through them and stuff, but there was nothing official. Mind you, I don't really believe official documents most of the time. Most of the time, as you saw, they're redacted. They're just put out for misinformation to steer people away from certain areas of investigation, to make people believe fictional reality. Those are the essentially the reasonings for putting out these documents, these official documents. However, there's a lot of information in regards to this Antarctica subject, tons, which is what I was explaining earlier. I could have done two multiple broadcasts separately just on this topic. But the base there was Base 211. That's apparently what it was called. And the Russians sent subs there. And not only that, the UK went there as well to try to root out any Nazis that were in Antarctica because they had intelligence reports. Apparently these countries had intelligence reports that there was a base there and they needed to get rid of it. Well, guess who went after them next? Yeah, America. They went after them and they sent a very well-known pilot at the time. His name was General Byrd, Admiral Byrd, actually. Sorry. They sent him. He was very well-known in the day. He was, it's said that he was as famous as Elvis at the time because he flew the poles, North and South Pole. He was a pilot that was known for navigating and discovering new land masses, claiming territories, all this stuff. And they sent him on a top secret investigation of Antarctica. And this is where it gets very interesting, folks. So here's a little clip on Base 211.
Судя по обнаруженным документам и воспоминаниям участников событий, нацисты на самом деле создавали в Антарктиде сверхсекретную базу. Она носила кодовое название «База 211». Уже с начала 1939 года между Антарктидой и Германией начинаются регулярные рейсы специально переоборудованного исследовательского судна «Швабия». На землю «Королевы Мод» перевозится горнопроходческое оборудование и другая техника – в том числе рельсовые дороги, вагонетки и огромные фрезы для проходки тоннелей. Туда же прибывают ученые, инженеры, высококвалифицированные рабочие. Для чего Германии была нужна столь удаленная база? Предположения высказываются разные. Одни полагают, что с ее помощью немцы хотели контролировать южные моря. Другие считают, что Германию привлекали полезные ископаемые Антарктиды, особенно уран, без которого невозможно создание сверхоружия. А кто-то утверждает, что на случай проигрыша в войне в Антарктиде готовилось убежище для элиты Третьего Рейха. И что якобы уже с 1942 года в Новую Швабию началась переброска ее будущих жителей. Не только ученых и специалистов, но и представителей нацистской партии и государства. И что туда же из Германии переносятся некие секретные производства.
So that again was a clip from the Russian documentary about the Operation UFO, Third Reich, Operation UFO. And that documentary was suppressed for a while and it was later released apparently by the Russians to present this information. Now that documentary has tons of information about this base and why they were doing it as well as the craft. We'll get into that in a moment. But I also wanted to point out, in regards to Antarctica, that it was widely believed at the time that there was a base there. And as you've seen from that clip, from the documents and the reports and the witness reports and all that stuff, that they were building railway systems, they had mining equipment, they had everything you needed to build a base. And they sent it over by the boatloads, and that was before the war. So why would they be doing that? Why would the Germans be doing that? It seems logical to me why they would be doing that. And then why there was such an effort after the war to expel them from that area. Because between their support in Argentina and if there was a base in Antarctica, it would be nothing for them to just go back and forth and to operate from the south. And now that is very, very propelling right there. If you could do that, you could have, you know, a base here and a base in Germany. When they lost that, they went south. Makes sense. Their escape route. That makes sense to me for sure. But here is something that I need to point out as well. Right here, this is about the submarines and the U-boats. I did mention, and you've seen in a couple clips, that they mentioned about the U-boat activity around Antarctica as well as Argentina. Now, here's a clip about Antarctica.
Давно в Антарктиде под километровым слоем льда обнаружены огромные озера. Температура воды в них плюс 18 градусов.
And it was a very strategic location, militarily speaking, as well as resources, because there's plenty of resources there. And some of the discoveries that were found in Antarctica during this time period, just after the war, are amazing, as you'll find out in a moment. But here is a clip on the actual landmass and the strategic area of Antarctica for building a base. Very, very interesting here.
Давно в Антарктиде под километровым слоем льда обнаружены огромные озера. Температура воды в них плюс 18 градусов. Над поверхностью воды находятся куполообразные своды, заполненные теплым воздухом. Не исключено, что из этих озер, постоянно подогреваемых снизу, в океан вытекают настоящие реки теплой воды. За тысячи лет они могли создать подо льдом и под землей огромные туннели, вполне пригодные для устройства тайных баз. Со стороны океана, поднырнув под прибрежными льдами, туда может спокойно зайти любая подводная лодка. Вот вам и готовая база. Без штормов и полярных холодов. Абсолютно скрытая от постороннего глаза. Вне досягаемости для любого противника.
Absolutely. So, we have reports of warm water creating tunnels in the glaciers, which are perfect for U-boats to enter under the ice, which, if you weren't aware of it, you wouldn't be able to detect right away that that's how these U-boats were entering into a base in the ice there. As well, it would be perfect to build under the ice because of how thick the ice was, and still is. I mean, that's very, very interesting. And now in Antarctica, you have the globalists with their grip on that area. It's definitely United Nations orientated now. You have a piece of it belongs to everybody, they claim, and all this stuff. But really, who's on that island? Who's there now? You've got scientists. You've got military operations, you've got intelligence services like the CIA in Antarctica. You've got all these groups there, and why would they be there? Well, I mean, I'll let you be the judge of that. I just needed to point out that there's a lot of curious activity going on in Antarctica, and I always knew so. That's what drew me to researching that continent a lot. Even before thinking about to do this broadcast, Antarctica was very compelling for me to look into because I knew that would be the perfect spot in the world for anybody to go to escape or have some sort of secret operation going on there, because nobody goes there, nobody lives there. It's very, very scarcely reported on. I mean, nobody goes there for vacations, really. Some explorers go there and stuff like that, but I'm sure if you got on the island and you went too far, you'd be meeting some security and they would tell you to get off the island because they're using that for something right now. I'm sure of it. I mean, give me a bit of time to research it, and I bet you I could find some evidence. I mean, you yourself out there listening, if you want to look into this Antarctic connection as well, I think there's a lot of information to be found there. Now, this base that was built by the Nazis in Antarctica, they had some technologies there that were met with force. Before I get into this, I should show you this. Because there was a battle there where they actually, according to this Russian documentary, which there is other evidence to support this. This information does not just solely come from this Russian documentary. There is other sources that claim this as well to back this up. But there was a battle there with Admiral Byrd's fleet. Now, The United States, and funded by the Rockefeller, by John D. Rockefeller, by the way, funded this campaign for Admiral Byrd to go there, bring a fleet. They said it was for scientific study. They said that was the reason for the operation. And this operation was called Operation High Jump. Now, there's tons of information about this. There's even a documentary. It was put out by the government, and it's called The Perfect Land, I believe it's called. I don't have it offhand here on the computer, and I didn't write the name of it down here, unfortunately. I'm pretty sure it's called The Perfect Land, or The Secret Land, sorry. It's called The Secret Land, and you can check that out on YouTube. It's an actual authentic military film that was put out by Admiral Byrd and the government to show what they were doing there. Now, it does show clips of them landing in Antarctica and, you know, doing some certain things. It was supposed to be an 8-month expedition. Admiral Byrd was to go there for 8 months and photograph the entire coastline of Antarctica and check it out and do all this stuff. And this was right after the Russians went there and UK went there to try to expel this Nazi base, apparently. So then the Americans send Admiral Byrd over with 4,000 troops. Now, why would you send 4,000 troops for a scientific expedition to Antarctica with tons of machinery, tons of planes, battleship, all this stuff? Why would you be sending that? And Admiral Byrd even admitted in a press conference, that it was military in operation, that this trip was militarily orientated. However, later on, with the film that came out, that they put out, it just made it look like it was some geological scientific expedition to Antarctica to, you know, look for resources and to map out the land, to create better images for mapping and etc., etc. And it was during this flight that from the log of Admiral Byrd that he claimed to have seen a woolly mammoth. He was flying his plane over Antarctica and he thought he saw an elephant. And as he got lower to the ground, he noticed that it was a woolly mammoth alive in Antarctica. And he documented that. He also documented many other strange things, which we're going to find out here. And this is... Now, that film, I wanted to point out, The Secret Land, does not show this aspect, which I'm going to show you. Obviously not, because it was a propaganda film. It was meant to show you, oh, this expedition, Operation High Jump, was solely for scientific purposes. There's no military agenda here, nothing like that. That was the cover story. So they put out the film just to make sure that the American public, as well as the world, believed that it was, you know, it wasn't a military operation, that they weren't going there to expel Nazis, put it that way. However, here's a video clip that you need to see.
После войны американцы, активно вербовавшие немецких ученых для работы в Соединенных Штатах, с удивлением обнаружили, что тысячи высококвалифицированных специалистов Третьего Рейха бесследно исчезли. Исчезло и более сотни подводных лодок. Среди погибших они не числились.
Возможно, американская разведка действительно располагала какими-то сведениями о том, что часть какого-то наследия, технического потенциала, ученые, действительно была вывезена из Германии. И естественно, что антарктические полярные зоны оказывались в поле зрения их внимания.
А тут еще показания немецких подводников, сдавшихся аргентинским властям. По всей видимости, все это чрезвычайно встревожило американцев. И в конце 1946 года знаменитый полярник и одновременно адмирал американских военно-морских сил Ричард Бёрд получает приказ уничтожить нацистскую базу в Антарктиде. Но не тут-то было. Отпор, который получила американская эскадра, до сих пор вызывает массу вопросов. Дело в том, что в Вашингтоне адмирал Бёрд докладывал не просто об истребителях с немыслимыми возможностями. Он говорил о нападении на экспедицию странных летающих тарелок, которые выныривали из-под воды и, двигаясь с огромной скоростью, нанесли экспедиции значительный урон. Вот как описывает этот бой, который произошел 26 февраля 1947 года, другой его очевидец. Участник экспедиции – опытный военный летчик Джон Сайерсон.
В
Они выскакивали из-под воды, как угорелые, и проскальзывали буквально между мачтами кораблей с такой скоростью, что потоками возмущенного воздуха рвало радиоантенны. Несколько корсаров успели взлететь с Касабланки. Я не успел и глазом моргнуть, как два из них, сраженные какими-то неведомыми лучами, брызнувшими из носовых частей этих летающих тарелок, зарылись в воду возле кораблей. Я в это время находился на палубе Касабланки. Я ничего не понимал. Эти предметы не издавали ни единого звука. Они безмолвно носились между кораблями и беспрерывно плевались убийственным огнем. Внезапно эсминец «Мердок», находившийся от нас в 10 кабельтовых, полыхнул ярким пламенем и стал тонуть. С других кораблей, несмотря на опасность, немедленно были посланы к месту катастрофы спасательные шлюпки и катера. Весь кошмар продолжался около 20 минут. Когда летающие тарелки снова нырнули под воду, мы стали подсчитывать потери. Они были ужасающими. Кто был хозяином этих тарелок? Неужели нацистская Германия?
So, met with resistance, Admiral Byrd's fleet went there for an 8-month expedition and returned home after only 8 weeks because they were attacked by disc-shaped saucers. Now, anybody who's looked into the Nazi technology, their rocket technology, as well as their spacecraft, they were trying to develop saucer, propelled energy, anti-gravity devices, sorry, long night. They were building anti-gravity devices so that they could fly vertically rather than have to take off. There's all sorts of things that they were developing. There's lots of blueprints, there's tons of videos and documentaries and evidence to support that they were working on these projects as well as had these projects. Such as Vril and all this other stuff. You could look it up, but what's interesting is that Admiral Byrd's fleet went to Antarctica and were met, and they seen saucers. Some of their ships were sank, and they had to turn back after 2 weeks. Now, the Russian documentary, after explaining this, the portion that I just showed you, they go to explain that it was, you know, it couldn't have been the German technology. They didn't have this technology back then. It's impossible. All this stuff. We could fly to the moon, but you don't have a ship that can go into the water and come out of the water and all this other stuff. It doesn't make sense, really, if you ask me. And this is the propaganda thing that I think is coming into play here, especially with the alien agenda. They want you to believe that it's aliens out there that are building these spacecraft. And notice, as well as Roswell and all this other stuff, that was happening during the war and after the war, that these spacecraft were suddenly spotted. There was some spotted before that, obviously, and if anybody's watched my UFO NWO Alien Agenda broadcast, which was the 6th broadcast, I think, that I did, I presented a ton of information showing that this technology is easily man-made. We have it now, we had it then. And also with the agenda behind telling us that there's aliens out there that came down here from another planet and all this stuff. There's a lot of mind control and a huge propaganda campaign involved with that, definitely. But Operation High Jump was definitely an important expedition. And that actually, after Operation High Jump, there was other subsequent missions that were sent to Antarctica, which are ongoing to today. They're still sending military troops down there, and these are called Operation Deep Freeze. And there's been about, I don't know what number we're at now, but I did see, I think the highest number I saw was Operation Deep Freeze 17. So they've been going constantly since Operation High Jump to Antarctica, delivering supplies, building bases there, all this stuff. Now, whether they merged with the Nazis there, or what have you. All I know is now that in Antarctica, it's a United Nations, essentially continent. There's a bit of a whole bunch of countries' involvement on there, but essentially it's been given up for the world, for United Nations. So essentially it's a globalist continent now. That is where you will find the globalist elite go if there's ever any catastrophe happening in our continent, or in our country, sorry, they have an escape route there that is definitely something to point out. But I also wanted to show you guys this video here. It's very, it's recent. And this is actually Google Maps showing an entranceway to something very peculiar in Antarctica. And this is a recent image. So I'll show you guys this.
So here we have Google Images, Google Maps. Here's the coordinates on the screen for you guys if anybody wants to check it out. And this is a giant entranceway or giant hole in the earth in Antarctica. And it goes right inside the earth. Now, I'm not going to start talking about the hollow earth theory or anything like that in regards to Admiral Byrd. I could do a whole episode on this, but here it is. I mean, there is entranceways, large craters that enter inside the earth in Antarctica, and the size of this entrance here, this particular one, you could definitely fit vehicles down inside of there, big trucks to bring supplies down, all that kind of thing. So there could be some things underneath the earth there. Definitely. And this would obviously be top secret. You wouldn't be able to see it in a Google Map image like this, but it is showing the entranceway. I'm sure there's others as well that we don't know about, but it is interesting to know the underground system in Antarctica.
So, underground tunnels in Antarctica. There you go. There's definitely something curious going on there. There have been since World War II, prior to World War II even, 1938, 39, the Nazi expeditions there, forming New Swabia, all that stuff. And then you have all this evidence supporting that Hitler didn't die, that he escaped to Argentina. I mean, it's there, you know what I mean? There's definitely connections to be made. There's a lot of documents that need to be released, or there's a lot of witness testimony that needs to be revealed, and I think a couple of these documentaries that are coming out, as well as written in some books, there's lots of witness testimony that has been presented to the people for their own consideration, obviously. I mean, choose what you want to believe in regards to all of this, but I think there's credible information that there was definitely something going on there. Now, it's with this Operation High Jump, they went there to expel the Nazis. They say it was for a scientific expedition. They went there, in my opinion, to expel the Nazis from the area, and were met with such superior technology because they almost had these crafts developed before they had to escape. And I believe they were always developing it since like the 1940, early 40s, into up to 1945, 1946 area. That's when I think they were developing this technology in Antarctica, so that they could, which was also presented to the Americans later on and stuff, which is why we're seeing all sorts of saucers. I saw a flying saucer even in Quebec when I was on tour with my band. I seen one flying over, and it exactly like that video described, exactly. It didn't make a sound. I barely noticed it. I had to look up, and I saw it hovering in a perfectly straight line. Just hovering over the hydro lines, not making a sound whatsoever. No lights on it. I'm sure if it was dark and it was nighttime, there might have been lights on it. But this was just before dusk. I could still see everything around me. It wasn't dark enough that I couldn't see. So I did see it passing above me. Didn't make a sound. Exactly like that video describes. Those saucers doing. And that was decades ago. So I really don't think that it's hard to believe that they have this technology now and that we don't know about it because it's top secret military intelligence. And another thing I forgot to mention earlier is the Russians started something called Operation Myth. There's a key word. And that was to dispel rumors about Hitler being alive and try to find out once and for all if Hitler was dead. There's a couple documentaries about Operation Myth out there you can check out for yourself. But I think that was all just a plot to get people to think that he did die, or that for anybody who was questioning it, because at the time I'm sure there's a lot of people that didn't believe that Hitler died. It was just like a lot of the so-called conspiracy theories that we have today. A lot of people just didn't believe it, so they had to do something about that. Operation Myth was formed. I didn't want to spend too much time on Operation Myth, but this would go in with what Stalin said, in that Hitler probably is alive and escaped to Argentina. I mean, he said that himself. There's a lot of, you got Roosevelt, President Roosevelt forming an FBI unit to search for Hitler in Argentina. You've got all this evidence here supporting that he didn't die. And the evidence is there for you to look at and for you to find out if you need more information on this. But the secret British bases in Antarctica during World War II, there was an operation called Tabarin. That's T-A-B-A-R-I-N, I believe. And there's there is a bit of information about this. I didn't include a lot of it in this broadcast because I had to pick and choose what topics I was going to cover in this broadcast today. It is an extensive topic here. Hitler escaping Germany. There's so much information. There's so many possible outlets, as you could see, that I could have taken to show you guys. I just tried to, you know, tackle a little bit about everything and try to compile it all into a big soup for you guys so that you guys could figure it out. But apparently the UK battled what they called Nazi ice warriors in 1945 in Antarctica. This was in a document that I read. There's all these documents that were put out that I couldn't really prove 100% or that I found kind of questionable. I didn't really discuss that on this on this broadcast today, but I did try to choose and pick the evidence that kind of ties together, the puzzle pieces that fit together. There is a lot here, obviously, that I couldn't get to or that I don't have access to, and I don't think anybody in the world has access to. It's very hard to find credible information about this stuff, especially when there is so much misinformation out there. When they want you to believe that Hitler died, and they're covering up for it, they're obviously going to do whatever they can to make us believe entirely opposite of what the truth is. It's their goal to create the fictional reality, which is what's happening, which is exactly what happened here. They don't want you to know that the world's most evil man, the world's most wanted man, escaped, and they let him escape, essentially, to live his life peacefully in Argentina without the threat of being detained as a war criminal, executed, or anything like that. He had a lot of support in Argentina, and I mean, when you have the Queen's Maud land being developed before that, all the reports of the Nazi bases. Now, I do think that it is very hard to find credible, absolute information about this. And the whole Hollow Earth theory is very interesting as well. This whole aspect of the tunnels going in Antarctica. I read a document that Admiral Byrd, apparently, when he met with these spacecraft and stuff, they let him live. They said he was a good person, but he went into one of these entranceways, and he met, and this is apparently, this is where the whole occult thing gets in it. There was a German society called the Annenerbe Society, and the Annenerbe Society was a Third Reich society, and they were really into the occult. They were actually really pushing for the developing of these space... saucers, as well as they were responsible for going out throughout Europe and looking for the history of the land to try to find out, to try to date back and piece together history and stuff. And this is also where the whole Aryan race comes into play here. They believe that the Aryan race are an ancient race that they belong to anyways, but that these people belonged, that lived inside of the earth, in these hollow points of the earth, and they believe that as above, so below. Now, this is something I'm really going to look into a little bit more now that I've stumbled upon this information and I know a little bit about it, is the Hollow Earth theory, because it is quite interesting in my opinion. Many people believe the earth is like a jawbreaker, essentially. It's a big hard rock, inside is molten lava all the time. I mean, it's always hot inside, even though the sun doesn't penetrate through. I mean, neutrinos do, I guess. They penetrate through the Earth's crust. But how could there be heat in the center of the Earth when the sun isn't directly radiating on it? It's hotter on the outside, in my opinion, than the inside. I mean, it probably is warm on the inside or something. I mean, there's a lot of things that need to be looked into there. But a lot of miners and mining operations have only been able to dig so deep to be able to prove that or anything. And when you have mining going on, you definitely have people inside the earth. It's like that's what they do. They develop mines down there. Now, apparently, Admiral Byrd found the entranceway to one of these things, and aliens apparently came out and talked to him. And there were Aryans, and they said that he was a good man, and that they were going to let him live because he was a good man. And they believed that he was a good man, and he had to go back and tell the world that the human race and the war and all that stuff was bad for humanity and all this stuff. I think this is all part of the propaganda thing, in my personal opinion. I mean, I definitely don't believe that I think that was just a bit of malarkey there. I looked, and this is Admiral Byrd's diary. This is what that relates to. So anybody who wants to look this up further, check out Admiral Byrd's diary. I mean, all you UFO and alien believers out there, definitely I'm giving you guys some information to look up. Myself, I would rather look up tangible, credible things that I can prove. And one thing I wanted to mention as well, before we wrap up the broadcast today, is that somebody did mention on my page earlier when I posted this broadcast. I mean, there was some people that were like, you know, I definitely think that Hitler killed himself. And there's people that were kind of like, why are you covering this topic and stuff? And the reason why is I think we deserve to know the truth. I believe that we deserve to know what really happened so that for future generations, they won't be lied to and they won't be living under some false doctrine, false reality. That's important for me. To figure out the truth, and that's why I called the show Unveiling the Truth, precisely. So, when looking into this, you know, it is up to you what you believe, but I'm looking for evidence if there really was a Nazi base there, you know, the technology that existed, the connections, the reports, first-hand reports, video footage, witnesses, that kind of thing. You know, I'm a kind of like an investigator, I guess you will. I like to investigate these things. But, I mean, there's a lot of information, tons and tons and tons of information in relation to the Hollow Earth theory. And like I was describing earlier, as above, so below, they believe that it was a mirror image on the surface of the Earth. There's a mirror image of that Earth underneath it. And it's almost like a utopia, I guess you could say. And that's where they believe that these Aryan race live, or as these New Agers believe, and a lot of Masons, etc., the Anunnaki live. And this is apparently who Admiral Byrd met when he went to these places, and he found entrances inside of the Earth, the Hollow Earth, and that's, I mean, that could be why they have these areas and these regions top secret, off access to the public, etc., etc. Now, there's a lot of evidence that needs to be supported for this, but one person mentioned, you know, I can believe in 9/11 being an inside job. I can believe that there's aliens out there, but I absolutely cannot believe that Hitler did not kill himself. And that was really strange to me, I think, because in one instance, the instance of Hitler's skull, you have forensic evidence proving that it was the skull of a female, that it wasn't Hitler's body, and then you have all these reports of Hitler escaping through the U-boats, the pilot flying him to Denmark, then getting on a U-boat, then going there. You have the FBI reports with all these witness reports that he actually did escape, plus the eyewitness testimonies that I showed you on video. Yet we don't have a single shred of forensic evidence proving that aliens exist. So I think I'd rather choose to believe that Hitler escaped rather than aliens. I mean, I'm going to focus my energy on that because I believe it to be true because of the evidence that's there. I mean, I'm a very logistical thinker. I do have an imagination. I have a lot of creativity. But at the same time, I don't want to present information if I don't have to. That's questionable. You know what I mean? I do want to try to show you guys the broadest picture possible and try to form as much of it, the puzzle, as I can to show you guys and have you guys decide for yourselves. So that's the most important thing here, is it is up to you what you believe in all of this, whether you believe Hitler escaped at the end of this broadcast or whether you believe he killed himself in the bunker. The choice is yours to believe. And remember, the word believe is be, lie, V-E. So you can be the lie or you can know for sure. And that's the difference. I choose to know for sure rather than to believe. So, I'm sorry. I mean, this is going to be a blue pill, red pill broadcast. Like I said, it's up to you. Some people are going to take the blue pill after watching this. Others are going to take the red pill. I think I took the red pill. My personal opinion. I believe I came upon the truth here with what's going on because of all this questionable evidence and tampered evidence and all the evidence I showed you guys today. So hopefully you guys took the red pill too. If not, it's all good. This is for your consideration only. And I do want to thank you guys for joining me today on Unveiling the Truth. As I said at the beginning of the broadcast, up next is a new show on the Truth Broadcast Network, Conspiracy Wire, with your host Mike Pochesny. Definitely going to be an interesting show. He's got a new website out for Conspiracy Wire, so check that out if you have the time, as well as all the other great shows on the Truth Broadcast Network. The Truth Broadcast Network's awesome. Definitely encourage those of you out there listening to tune in to other shows on the network. And don't forget to tune in to Unveiling the Truth every Saturday night from 10 p.m. till midnight Eastern Time. So thank you guys for joining me on tonight's episode. And the truth is out there. Should start playing some X-Files music here, but I'm going to pass on that. Instead, I'll give you guys the peace sign, because that's what we live for, is peace. Cheers, guys. Thanks for watching.